Hey guys, it's Dani. Today we're going to discuss about the orchid species that I acquired throughout 2018. Yes, I know the year is not over yet, but it's highly doubtful that I will make any more hauls or any more purchases, especially because it's winter and throughout the Europe it's already been snowing and temperatures are pretty low, so it's a little bit risky to order anything anyway. So being that this year was a little bit different, I didn't do the unboxings of the hauls because there weren't really any hauls. I purchased orchids, yes, but they were one or two from eBay, nothing worth making an unboxing for anyway. There are a few that you guys might have missed. Some of them you might already know, some you missed. I didn't talk about them. So today I'm gonna show you the new species or varieties or new types of hybrids that entered my collection this year. And with this occasion, do a little bit of an update on the ones that I did present. So that said, let's get to work. Let's start with something you guys don't know I have. But I do, and it's wonderful. This is one of the most exciting new species for me. This is a Huntleia bertii. If you're English, you will pronounce it as bertii. If not, possibly not, just to eliminate the confusion there. This is a worm-growing epiphytic orchid, and you might say it is a monopodial. It looks like a vanda. It really isn't. It is sympodial. It has a rhizome, and I will link you down below to the article of the AOS on this orchid. There are a few species, and of course, being that it is new, I cannot really say anything about its culture and care just yet. The AOS proposes that you never actually let it become super bone dry because it doesn't have storage devices, and indeed it doesn't have pseudobulbs. So I am growing it in self-watering with Leca, and so far it looks really, really good. It is actually producing quite a multitude of new roots inside the fan here. Flowers should arise from between the leaves, as you might expect. I am not sure about its growth cycle behavior, if it produces terminal spikes at some point or not, so I don't know all of these details since I don't really have much information or actually much experience with it. However, the flower just looks so incredibly wild and spectacular. I have been eyeing this orchid for a while now. I just didn't really take the plunge, but I did find it at a reasonable price. I purchased it, and I'm really happy to observe it, learn about it, and share it with you. Next up, two orchids that I purchased around the same time. This is a Ceratostylus rubra and an orchid that looks like a Phalaenopsis, and it is, I think, currently reclassified as a Phalaenopsis, but I sometimes choose to disregard that. This is Doritis pulcherrima. The Ceratostylus rubra produces tiny little orange flowers, so I guess you can understand the appeal. And also, it is supposed to be a worm grower, easy to grow even by beginners, and I thought, well, what a cute little species to try out. Ever since I purchased it, she has actually grown. This is a new growth, and I hope you can see how weird the growth pattern is. It produces new growth from pretty much on top of the other growth, and in the end it will bush out, it will grow in height. Reminds me slightly of a maxillaria, and if you look right here, this is where the new growth will start. You can see it's covered in sheets right now. It will start to produce a leaf like this one, and it will transform into yet another fan, if I can call it like that. So very interesting pattern of growth. And also look at the roots, they are very fine, very fuzzy. It was impossible to remove all of the medium from the root system. I just let it be, and that is that. It will eventually decompose and go away. But I'm happy it's taking to Leca, because removing old medium from those roots, it's simply impossible. If I would have to choose an orchid with the most brittle or sensitive roots, it's this one. Not even the Phragmipediums are so sensitive. Next to it, the Pulcherrima. This, for now, behaves pretty much like a Phalaenopsis, but the flower spikes on Doritis generally are vertical. They don't really grow towards the light, or if they do, they just lean a little bit. As you can see, mine is perfectly straight. And the orchid herself really does look like a Phalaenopsis. Now, the spike is not terminal. It comes from the sides, in between the leaves, just like a Phalaenopsis. It's not a sympodial orchid. This is a monopodial. And as you might know, I didn't really enjoy the flowers. This orchid arrived with a flower spike, but the flowers and buds blasted. So I'm guessing she was a little bit stressed with adjusting to my environment. But yeah, I will cut away this spike, let her just recover, grow this leaf which has started to grow actually, and hopefully will get better bloomings in the future. Speaking about Phalaenopsis and other related orchids, one of my goals this year was to have more summer blooming Phalaenopsis or species or novelty hybrids, pretty much anything that was not a complex hybrid from the flower shop. And I will not show you all of the hybrids, but just some highlights. One of the species that I bought this year is the Phalaenopsis ludemanniana, which is supposed to be a summer bloomer, but it recently surprised me with the formation of this flower spike. Whether it will bloom in the winter slash spring, I do not know. It might form and bloom in the summertime, but I just thought it was interesting. And the orchid herself is actually actively growing at the moment, even though it got a little bit cold, so she might be a little bit out of season, to be fully honest. An orchid which does not appear to be out of season is the Phalaenopsis immobilis. This is a variegated variety, and isn't she absolutely adorable? If you missed it, I'll link you down below. I'll try to find it at some point in the year. She produced a variegated root. As you can see, the roots look pretty normal on this orchid. Well, at some point, it produced this root, which had a super bright magenta tip, which is not visible now because it went into the medium, but at some point it was very visible and really beautiful. Not all of the roots look like that, but this orchid would just be so lovely if you could grow it in a basket or mount it or something of the sorts. I cannot, I mean I can, but I don't really have the time to care for it properly, and I just feel more secure with pots. What I wanted to show you was that this orchid is starting to produce a flower spike. She's still a seedling, but these orchids and Phalaenopsis generally can produce flower spikes even if they're very, very young. Now, this is an intergeneric Phalaenopsis, if you will. This is Ascomnopsis erenedubkin. I purchased this one earlier this year and she is doing great. I had a little bit of nervousness with this one because people are saying it's kind of finicky, and it's a slow grower. Yes, it's not so finicky though, at least until now. And if I remember correctly, it is a hybrid between Ascocentrum and Phalaenopsis. So it will look beautiful. It will resemble a Phalaenopsis, but an improved one. It's something I really wanted for a long time and it is doing great. It has a lot of sap droplets, but it does not have pest or anything. And these two come from my recent haul, but I just wanted to include them. I have a very tiny Sideria japonica here, which is currently reclassified as a Phalaenopsis, but yet again I choose to call it a Sideria because it means something else in cultivation. Even though genetically, yes, it's a phal, in cultivation it doesn't act like a phal. And also something which I suspect has not been reclassified to Phalaenopsis, I shall not be surprised if it will. This is a tuberolabium. It's very similar to the Sideria when it blooms, but obviously not identical. And I'm not entirely sure if there is any genetical difference big enough between the two that will prevent this one from becoming a Phalaenopsis in the future, but you never know. I would not be surprised. Next up, something you guys definitely don't know about because it arrived yesterday. No, it's not the Masdevallia, it's what's next to the Masdevallia. Some of you will recognize this and will be a bit shocked and horrified because this is Dendrobium cuthbertsoni and it is a cool grower. Why did I buy it? Well, because I have a plan. That's why. Anyway, this is the Dendrobium I've been eyeing for a year, and I've always in my mind thought of setups to grow it in. So I've been thinking about clay pots, about the humidifier, about how can I create a setup for them. And actually I do have a plan in mind, which I'll talk about when the worm season comes. Right now it's pretty cold and this guy has no reason to actually die off because of temperature. But just so you guys know that I have him, just for the sake of the proof, the video proof, I have him. I bit the bullet because I do have some faith in what I'm gonna do next summer. So this type of Dendrobium, not only does it look very interesting, it also produces massive, massive, massive flowers that are all very multicolored. I don't know what variety this is. It could be anything. It could be pink, could be orange, could be red. I have no idea. It was an eBay purchase and it is actually my last auction. I really wanted this guy and thankfully the rich bidder didn't bid 100 euros on this guy, so I was able to buy it. But it is my last auction, this guy. I currently potted it in sphagnum moss with a top layer of bark. The orchid looks really, really good. It actually has quite a lot of roots. It came from moss, so the transition is smooth. This is a self-watering pot that has a gauge so I can control the level, and I just pulled out the Mazdi here just to give you a little update on this setup. It does actually work pretty well. So I thought, you know what, it is now or never. If this setup doesn't work, then I don't know what will. And it doesn't include clay pots, but it will include many things that will promote cool temperatures. It remains to be seen what will happen next summer. Next up, bulbophyllums. I told you a long time ago that I think I want to have more bulbophyllums, but I actually prefer the stinky ones flower-wise, and being that I had a balcony connected to the house, I really didn't want to get any stinky bulbophyllums and not know what to do with them when they're in bloom. So now I'm free to go around and pick the most beautiful stinky bulbophyllums, which I did. This guy is older in my collection. I'm not sure if I purchased it this year or last year, to be fully honest with you guys. I purchased it at a very, very young age. It only had these growths, I think, when I purchased it. So it was really tiny, and it did actually grow quite a lot. One thing that I noticed with this guy is the leaf tip dieback. Now, I thought this was because of the LECA. Maybe pH, maybe salts, maybe whatever. But I actually recently saw another YouTuber with this orchid. He was growing it either mounted, either in a bark mixture. And then I thought, okay, it's not the LECA, not the pH, not deficiency, not salt buildup. What else could it be? Moisture. Therefore, I potted this guy in the setup that you saw, the Cuthbertsoni and the Masdevallia earlier, moss, and then a top layer of bark just to prevent algae, nothing more. I actually bought a different type of top layer to try out in a different video. And this is a self-watering pot, but the reservoir really is not super big. This is actually mainly for summertime. In the wintertime, I just sprinkle a little bit of water and the moss becomes moist and even and everything is okay. So I have been growing these guys for the past month, I think, or so in the setup, and they're actually doing really, really great. Let's just see some root growth. There we have it. Mind you, it's only been a month, so there's no spectacular root growth just yet, and the pot is big, but whatever roots are exposed, they look pretty, pretty good. So I'm curious to see if the whole leaf tip dieback situation resolves itself. You can see the new growth looks okay so far, but it's when the leaf matures that it becomes prone to having the dieback. So we'll see. I specifically let these just to show you guys. Now I can go ahead and cut them. But just so you know, yeah, it had leaf tip dieback, and I did see another individual potted in a totally different thing, organic materials, which had dieback. So we'll see if the moisture fixes it. And then this is a more recent bulbophyllum. This is Cyropetalum, which is actually a bulbophyllum. I think it has been reclassified. Daisy chain. This guy produces the flower of my dreams when it comes to bulbophyllums. It looks like a daisy. It is yellow and has that really nice little skirt. I call it a skirt. I really like him, and I purchased him in really good condition. He had multiple new growths, which are maturing at the moment, as you can see. So I'm hoping he will actually bloom pretty soon. The setup is the same as the other one. So far, so good. Looks really, really nice, this guy. With this one, I didn't really want to risk LECA. I didn't want to see if he would have issues. I chose to go directly to moss because it might actually be better for me in summertime. These guys drink a lot of water. They don't like to dry out. And even though my Elizabeth Ann Buckleberry, which you might have seen in bloom on Instagram, you'll see it in bloom at the end of the month as well. That one is doing great in LECA and self-watering, and I don't think I want to move it yet. Even though that one is okay, being that I had issues with this one might mean that there will be individuals out there which might have some issues with hydration, I presume. So I just chose moss. I might go for full moss with the other one in the future as well. We'll see what suits me better in the summertime. For now though, this setup has worked pretty, pretty great. Another group of orchids I really wanted to have more of this year was Cattleyas or Cattleya types, but I wanted some with fluffy flowers or bigger flowers. This goal was not super fully fulfilled, to be honest with you guys. To me, Schroeder has a great variety of Cattleya hybrids. And in the summer, I did make a haul. I got a few Cattleya types that I really liked, and I was actually scheduling my birthday haul made out of Cattleya hybrids, which that fell apart. So I got instead Phalaenopsis. But the goal with the fluffy cats didn't really come to fruition this year. I did, however, get a few of them that I'm really excited for. First of all, a new species This is, well, it says Brassavola, but it's not. It's Rincolalia nowadays, Digbyana, variety Mr. Chase, which is an awarded variety. Now, I do have another Rincolalia. I have the Glauca since last year and it actually bloomed. It's still doing very, very good, but the Digbyana is the one with the frilly lip, with the floofy flower, kinda. So there we have it. I don't think I showed this one to you, although she has been in my collection for a few months already. And it is growing a new growth there. We have quite a lot of root production. Next to it, we have a Lelia. Now, this one might have been reclassified to Cattleya, but anyway, this is Lelia Crispa, variety Flammea Baronessa, crossed with Sibling. I'm not sure how this one will look like, but hopefully spectacular. This is pretty recent. It's about 2 months since I have it, and she is growing a new growth, no new roots. This is the type of orchid which I presume will produce a new root system when the new growth will be mature. Sadly, the new growth has started a little too high, as you can see. So it's gonna take a while until the roots go to the medium, start to absorb water. But this orchid does have quite a few roots, so she's not dehydrated, which is good. But if it were dehydrated, I would have considered putting some medium here. Anyway, this new growth, I presume, will be quite tiny and will not bloom. So next year, I don't think we're gonna see her in bloom. Who knows, though? But hopefully the year after that she will be completely adjusted and bloom, and we're going to enjoy another Lelia type orchid. Behind her, you already know this one if you've watched the Schroeder haul. This is a complex hybrid which looks so incredibly great. I forget how to actually read the name. Chantilly Lace Twinkle. This is an orchid I saw many years ago in pictures and I thought, oh, I would really like to have that one. So Schroeder had it at a seedling size, and as you can see, she's not a seedling. She matured this growth during the year, and hope you can see the shape of the pseudobulbs. They're very thin at the base and then go into this very round and plump shape. I absolutely love them. Looks more like a dendrobium, and she has three leaves on top. And now she's working on a new growth. She reminds me a lot of the Vanagara because that one produces a lot of leaves on the top as well. And in the back, we actually have a proper Cattleya, which is not a new genus or anything for me. However, it is the very first Cattleya which I've ever wanted. This is the Purple Cascade, and those of you who are old school on my channel, you might remember I tried to purchase this one in my very first, I think, filmed Schroeder haul. It might have been my first ever Schroeder haul many years ago. Purchased this one, it was mislabeled. What to do? I saw this orchid at Brad's and it looks spectacular. It's that beautiful white with magenta splashes, the contrast, you know me. And finally, I find it again at Schroeder. This is her, she's doing great, and I do think I see something forming in the sheath at the base. I'm not sure, but I really, really do hope I will get to see some blooms soon from this orchid, because this is history for me. This is the very first Cattleya of my wish list. If I ever had a wish list, it started with her. So it's a pretty special orchid for me, and I cannot wait for it to bloom. And just to end the video, behold, are we surprised? I don't think we are. Yes, another Nelly Eiler. How many Nelly Eilers did I kill until now? A million. How many will I continue to buy until I get it right? About a million, probably. Hopefully not, but just in case you were wondering. Now again, with this one, I have some plans for the setup. For now, this might actually be a temporary setup, being that I did have quite the success with this one, which is another red intergeneric, which may or may not have some Miltoniopsis in its parentage. I thought, well, you know what? I can try to apply the same things to the Nelly Eiler and see how we go. This one I did pass the summer with, so that's good. So moss right now proves to be the setup, the one for these types of orchids. So I will actually try the Miltoniopsis that I have, which are doing actually pretty okay, and the new Nelly Eiler in moss. And not only this, if things go according to plan, I will actually change the pot to self-watering once again. Right now, I wanted to put these orchids in transparent pots. This is potted in a transparent pot as well. I just placed some bark on top just so I avoid algae, but that's about it. So both of them are in transparent pots at the moment because I want to monitor the root system. And if I discover that things go according to plan, I will actually go ahead with the self-watering pot. I will stick to the format that the Hoyara actually loved. The Hoyara, you guys, oh my god. I've been struggling for a year and a half or more to acclimate it to Leica. No, no thank you. When I put it in Moss, it just blew off. I am actually still shocked and surprised about the Hoyara. So if the Hoyara could do it, well, why not hope for the Nelly Eiler as well? And on that bombshell, I think it's time to end. I hope you guys have a wonderful weekend. Next week, we are testing out some more products. I'm a little excited for the Rockwool thing, because if we can use the Rockwool as Moss, then hey presto, we have an inorganic version to Moss, which, you know, based on the history with the Cintiq, I'm not sure if it's possible. To be fully honest, I love Moss, I'm not sure if we can ever replace it, hopefully we'll see. So stay tuned for that, and you know the drill, like or dislike this video below, subscribe to my channel for regular orchid videos, tutorials, Q&As, and other fun orchid related subjects, and if you like YouTube to notify you whenever I upload a new video, just turn on notifications for my channel. And if you're wondering what products and setups I do use in my grow space, again, I have everything listed down below in the description. So with that said, I'll see you guys next time. Bye.